Belinda presents this unabridged recording of A Daughter's Courage, written by Renita De Silva and read by Nikki Patel. Dedication. For my mother, Perdita Hilda De Silva, the kindest, warmest, most generous and wonderful person I know, my role model and inspiration. Prologue. The Temple. Happy dreams. In a scenic corner of India, beside sparkling fields and across from a jungle, near rain-bejeweled coffee plants lined with areca trees and pepper vines, a small temple nestles, slowly going to ruin. It has seen many generations come and go. It is hiding countless secrets deep within its crumbling walls. Woodlice have burrowed into its pillars and anthills adorn its steps and cling to its small veranda. Cobwebs stretch from one end of the temple bell to the other, once gleaming yellow, now tarnished rust, once heralding devotees and massaged by 1,000 pious palms, now caressed by silvery skeins of spidery secretions and frantic with the frenzied patter of trapped insects. People trees have conspired to form a canopy over the temple, hiding it from the world. Warm air, infused with the zesty tang of ripening pepper and the smokiness of coffee, hangs respectfully still around the temple, loath to disturb the somber peace. A falling down cottage is just visible between the columns of deciduous roots gracing the temple courtyard, which are almost as tall as the overgrown trees to which they belong. The disintegrating, moss-steeped walls of the cottage glow orange-gold in the shafts of sunlight, occasionally piercing the vibrant green awning of branches, playing hide-and-seek with the ants that scurry around, searching for crumbs. The wall of tumble-down bricks surrounding the temple and the cottage is almost completely covered with velvet moss. From certain angles, with its foliage-festooned steps leading up to its open cave of a mouth, lush vegetation parting to afford a tantalizing glimpse of the deity within, its small shrine draped with vine and creeper garlands, its offerings of rotting leaves and mulchy bark. The temple looks as if it is smiling, a slumbering child experiencing happy dreams. Now, Mumbai, India. Chapter 1. Kavya. Verbal Volley. Kavya hears the landline ringing as she puffs up the stairs to the flat. She recognises it as hers from the ringtone, loud and strident. It will most likely be her mother. Fitting, then, the ringtone. Everyone else has her mobile number. She considers leaving it, taking her time up the stairs. She's not quite ready to have the conversation she knows she must with her mother. But what if it's an emergency? What if something's happened? She sprints up, cursing for the millionth time the fact that she lives on the 5th floor, cursing Balu, the lift attendant, who keeps promising to call the engineer to fix the broken, permanently, it seems, elevator, and then sits about smoking and gossiping with the gatekeeper. He pulls a suitably sad face and shrugs his shoulders when Kavya grumbles to him, scratching his head and drawling languidly, "Engineer is coming now, give him some time. This time of year is very busy for him." As Kavya pauses to take a breath, noting that the phone has stopped ringing and feeling stupidly relieved, she thinks back to the several rants she has voiced at the tenants' meetings, trying time and again to rouse the residents against Mr. Nandkishore, president of the Tenants' Association, who is in cahoots with the landlord and lets things slide. What a waste of energy that I could have put to better use. She has tried talking to the other residents when passing them on the stairs, attempting to make them enraged enough to dislodge Mr. Nandkishore. She even tried to bribe them with those divine cream buns from Hazmat Bakery once, the last time she's spending good money on them. They agree with her, but when push comes to shove, side with Mr. Nandkishore, who, she has since found out, makes sure they get certain concessions, including leeway when paying the rent. Which is why they are lukewarm towards her righteous anger, lethargic despite the perpetually broken lift, despite having to climb endless flights of stairs. But this is the absolute limit, she thinks as she shifts her shopping from one hand to another. She cannot remember the last time the lift was working. Tell the landlord I have exposed him on that blog that rates rental properties, she raged the last time she saw Mr. Nandkishore. Are, who will listen to your lone dissenting voice when everyone else is happy? Mr. Nandkishore had said with a smirk. They're not happy. They keep quiet because you bribe them, she had spat. Move if you're not happy, Mr. Nandkishore had said, grinning, expertly skirting the issue of the bribes. But Kavya likes her flat. Aside from the fact that it is on the fifth floor, it is perfectly suited to her needs. She likes its central location, likes that it is a 2-minute walk away from the train station. Besides, why should she move? It would be accepting defeat. It would be bowing down and giving in. She has always told herself, and anyone who will listen, plus her mother, who won't, that she will live her life on her terms only. Not her mother's, or Mr. Nandkishore's, or the landlord's. But now, after the events of the past few weeks, she's not so sure. She pauses on the stairs and closes her eyes, trying to chase away the upset that swamps her. It's over. You've survived. Pick yourself up now and look ahead. You are a warrior. She hears her beloved grandmother's voice in her ear, pictures her eyes twinkling with pride when she says it, and is struck by a sudden pang to see her, speak with her, explain her situation. Her grandmother would understand and sympathize, unlike her mother. You were born screaming, ready for a fight. A tomboy, hi, what shall I do with you? Her mother's vociferous tones push away her grandmother's soft, soothing presence inside her head. Her mother, eyes flashing fire, hitting her forehead with her palm. You should be a lawyer the way you argue with me. Which is precisely why Kavya hasn't become a lawyer, or a doctor, or an engineer, or pursued something respectable. She hears those two words in her mother's voice, spiked with disappointment. The phone has started up again. She charges up the stairs as fast as she can, which is not fast at all. Everything, including the gym, has been on hold since she... Oh God, she cannot think about it. Not now, when the phone call is most likely her mother. It will require all of her energy just to field her mother's incessant prying once Kavya informs her of her decision. Out of breath, she fumbles with a key and pushes open the door to her flat. Hello! She pants, her palms hurting from where the shopping bags have dug into the flesh. She looks at the bags by the door where she unceremoniously plonked them as she came in and sighs at the spreading puddle underneath them. The eggs? Or the tomatoes that she spent an age selecting, making sure she got the juiciest ones, fancying a salad to chase away the headache that's been rippling through her skull. Her mood is not improved when she hears her mother's voice yelling, Is that you, Kavya? She's tempted to yell right back, Who else could it be? Kavya! Her mother's voice thunders down the line. Why does her mother always shout when speaking on the phone?
Yes, Ma, I'm right here.
What's the matter? Why are you huffing and puffing, sounding like you have a herd of elephants chasing you?
Her mother chuckles.
Speaking of elephants, you'll never believe what...
Now that Kavya has discerned from her mother's familiar greeting, her tone of voice, that nothing catastrophic has occurred, irritation buds, chafing, overflowing, despite all her resolutions after every altercation with her mother to be nice the next time.
I sound breathless because I am. I ran all the way up the stairs thinking it was an emergency. How many times have I told you not to keep calling unless it's urgent, Ma?
She hears the petulant whine in her voice and bites her lip. Why does her mother reduce her to a whinging 13-year-old every single time? Why does Kavya let her?
What do you mean, don't keep calling? If I don't, then I might never get to speak to you. What with your busy life.
How can her mother make a perfectly ordinary word like busy sound so obscene, so worthy of disdain?
I want to speak to my only daughter at least once a week. Thank you very much. I think that constitutes urgent in my book.
Kavya sighs. Her mother is nothing if not tenacious. If she has made up her mind to speak to Kavya, she will. Even if it means having to keep ringing on and off all day and into the evening until Kavya gives in and answers the phone. Kavya closes her eyes and leans against the wall as she catches her breath. She wants to strip down to her underwear and lie down under the fan. She wants to open the fridge, pull out the bottles that survived last night's binge and down them to drown her troubles. She wants to hide in the folds of her grandma's voluminous sari skirts like she used to as a child when she was wanted by her mother for some infraction or other, breathing in the scent of stale talc, old celebrations and mothballs, comfort and sweat. It was unfortunate that wanting to be with her grandmother meant that she had to also endure her mother's censure emanating off her in chagrin-scented waves, her mother's smell when Kavya was around, disapproval and heartache.
What would you do if you found out the truth, Ma?
She wants to run away from her mother's forceful voice in her ear, back down the stairs, out into the bustle and throb of humanity, and keep walking until she comes to the sea, letting the warm waves lap over her feet and ankles, her thighs, her waist.
I have elephants on my mind, her mother says.
Outside, the world moves on, while in her apartment, her supposed haven, Kavya is catapulted back into childhood and young adulthood. No matter how far she goes, she can never outrun her mother's upset, her displeasure in her. And it is only going to get worse when Kavya tells her ma that she has decided this career is not for her, the bland statement hiding a truth her mother must never know, as she will never be able to handle it. Kavya shudders, tempted to put down the phone, but her mother would just ring again, and keep on ringing, not accepting no for an answer. Once, in the midst of a raging argument, Kavya had unplugged the phone and her mother had called old Mr. Singh next door, who, despite being short of hearing, heard Kavya's mother's summons. So insistent was her stubbornness in getting hold of her daughter. How she had Mr. Singh's number, Kavya doesn't know. But if there is one thing Kavya has learned, it is not to underestimate her mother when she wants something. This is why it gives Kavya particular pleasure that so far she has managed to resist her mother's attempts to slot her into a neat little box to shape Kavya according to her ambitions and desires for her.
So far, yes, but...
She sighs deeply, then pulls herself together.
I might be defeated, but I am not giving in. I have no choice but to go back, yes, but it is only a temporary measure until I figure out what to do.
In the small strip of land generously called the garden, 5 stories below, the Mali is half-heartedly tending to the plants, the hibiscus-like open red palms bestowing blessings, the sunny smiles of marigolds. The watchman at the gate waves a car in and manoeuvres another, wanting to leave, into waiting in a corner, while at the same time talking non-stop to Ballu, the lift attendant, who is smoking perfect rings into the sky as he watches the drama unfold. The man in the waiting car puts his head out of the window and curses at the gatekeeper. Kavya can't hear anything from up here, even with the windows wide open, but she can guess what is being said. The gatekeeper remains unperturbed by the driver's agitation, pausing in his directing to guffaw. Bony shoulders shaking with mirth, presumably at something Ballu has said. Outside the gates, by the roadside, a boy skips in the puddles left behind from the morning's rain. Rickshaws honk. Cars.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.